This show contains explicit language and references, and not permitted for any listener under the age of 18 years of age. Listener discretion is advised.
Rico Costantino, and you're listening to my favorite show in the whole wide world, The Bolin Alley.
Take two, Rob Dickless, take it away. My own mother doesn't refer. My mother calls me King. The prince's mother calls him Prince.
Please, people, let me tell you, there is no need to fear. The prince is here. I have come back to rescue your mundane pro wrestling lives.
We are racist. We hate stupid fucking white people, so go ahead.
I do. I hate most anybody below the poverty line. What a dumb... Wait, are you implying that Jim Cornette's helped underage teenagers? I'd live in India before I'd live in this motherfucker.
Newmar did, see what happened to him.
Sean Waltman could not support his own coke habit, let alone a faction, a unit, or a main event run.
Is that where they're recording the ROH TV tapings?
They couldn't fill that house up if they needed to.
Alright, New Jack, come get me, motherfucker! I'm on Burnett Avenue with a hobo! I just thought it was the sweet aroma of piss and shit.
Ah, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back for a new edition of the Bolin Alley. This is the season four finale. And Kenny, how we doing?
We're doing marvelous. We had a bit of a three-week layoff this time, and of course we're getting ready to get into the holidays. And believe it or not, through the holidays this time, for the first time in many years, OVW is going to be running a lot of shows during the holidays. So we're going to be a bit on the busy side on this end, a little busier than I'm accustomed to. And so we're going to take a bit of a break, probably going to be it maybe to as late as late January or February before we come back with season five of the Bolin Alley. And you've got some big announcements about how that's going to go, don't you?
Yeah, we're actually going to be streaming live video of the Bolin Alley.
That's the plan anyway.
And it's not going to be just me and Kenny and Chris sitting at computers on webcams.
Oh, no, that's for those jerk-offs to do.
Yeah,
we don't do that shit.
We don't do that. We've got a professional setup. We're actually going to be doing it talk show style. So we can have people sit down with us, talk with us. You can see the live video version. Or if, you know, you don't have your video codecs working or, you know, whatever, you don't have, you know, basic stuff that most computers have, you can listen to the audio version as well. Both are going to be up on our website. We're having some technical difficulties because we're upgrading our website, so that's why our player isn't working right now, unfortunately. But you can listen to us. If you are listening to us, you're on Angry Marks. But if you're not, we're sorry. You're probably listening to us on YouTube right now. So.
Well, that's just fine. We get the majority of our listeners between Angry Marks, and I think so. What do we got, like five or six affiliates out there? And then once they play us, YouTube picks us up, I believe.
Yeah, we're on YouTube. We're at Angry Marks. We're in the talks with a few different places right now about affiliating. We'll have more info on that when that comes up. But We are an affiliate with Go Fight Live, so you can listen to us on GFL.TV or GoFightLive.TV.
And from what I understand, excuse me, they said it wouldn't be a bowling alley if I didn't cough on it, and I've still been recovering from some lung problems. But where was that going? I'm getting so old and senile, I can't even remember what the next sentence was I was going to say. Well, when I think about it, I'll come back to it. I totally forgot what I was going to say. That's why the prince needs to be here. The prince is off tonight. I've ordered him to take the night off. No bowling alley for him. Because tomorrow night in Clarksville, Indiana, at the Colgate Center, yeah, the people that make toothpaste, and I know a lot of you people out there have no idea what the hell I'm even talking about. That's stuff you put in your mouth to brush your teeth with. It's called a cleaning agent is what it is. It's the yellow off of there, so those of you that have that problem can now fix it. But we're going to be over there at the Colgate Center tomorrow, and it's going to be the in-ring debut in the tri-state area. First time ever in his professional career. He was in a legendary battle royal in Nashua, New Hampshire, in which me, the Prince, Ox Baker, and Tito Santana went to the Final Four in his first ever match in a ring. So that was quite impressive right there that the Bolins were able to take it to the Final Four against Ox and Tito, but he has not been in the ring since as a professional wrestler. And he's now 24 years old. He was 16. It's been 8 years since he has climbed back into a professional ring. He decided at a very young age that his mind was way too far elevated above most of those people out there, and that a thinking man need not soil his hands, need not get himself dirty by climbing into the squared circle. But by the board members at OVW, they have ordered him into a six-man tag tomorrow night against Raul Amada and two partners of his choice, Moose and Rocco, of course, the biggest, baddest team probably in wrestling today, are going to be partners with my son. I don't care who they pick. I don't care if he goes out and gets Godzilla and King Kong. They ain't going to have a chance against Moose and Rocco. And that's going to leave a dirty, stinking Mexican all alone for my son to make short work of right over there in Colgate, Indiana. And then, Rob Dickin, you're going to be my special guest. You're going to be sitting right alongside of me at my autograph table, where I make hundreds of thousands of dollars over the course of the year. My tax man will be glad to hear that. And you can sit right beside me selling all my DVDs and pictures and all the great things that we do. And then we're going to go out and have a celebratory dinner at a place to be named later, mainly because we don't want a bunch of fans running it. It'll just be me, you, and the Prince, and maybe a couple of special guests, and you know my little lady friends that like to come along with us. And we're going to have a big old party tomorrow night celebrating Christopher Bolin's first professional win in the tri-state area.
Yeah, definitely. And if I have to hear another one of those guys doing the announcing give him one of the worst introductions, I might have to just...
They don't like the Bolins. Yeah. They're jealous of the Bolins. They're upset about everything that we've accomplished in life, and they think Christopher has had a sheltered life and that hasn't had to earn anything that he's got. Well, I got news for you. In his 24 years of living with me and being around me in the professional wrestling business, he has earned more and learned more than anybody that's ever listened to this radio show. I can promise you that. And that includes marks, wrestlers, retired wrestlers, up-and-coming wrestlers. You don't know more than the Prince. I don't know more than the Prince. He is a walking encyclopedia when it comes to professional wrestling. And I guarantee you, he will figure out a way to emerge victorious tomorrow night in Clarksville, Indiana.
Definitely. And if he doesn't get the right introduction, I think I might have to say something.
Well, we'll believe me, I got a lot of power and a lot of stroke over there. And if he don't get the introduction he deserves, we'll make sure that he does get one. And I think you know what I mean.
Absolutely. This is the finale of the season. Like Kenny said, we're going to start the video version, nice produced talk show style version, probably late January, early February.
And, yeah, me and the Prince need a little holiday time off there, kind of recharge our batteries a little bit. Plus, we want to get this video thing up and going here real well and try something a little different. From what I understand, we've been getting anywhere from a low of 6,000 downloads to a high of 10 or 12,000 downloads. That's not where I want. I want 50,000. I want 100,000 downloads. We are the most entertaining show on the radio today. I saw some of these award shows being given out, and they're posting all these different sites. And they did not have the Bolin Alley listed on any of them. Once again, media jealousy. They are jealous of everything that we've accomplished, everything that I did even before I came to this network. And they don't want to compete with me. They know they can't compete with me in the Prince. Not only are we the most educated, we're the most entertaining, and we tell it like it is. We don't sugarcoat anything, and we ain't scared of anybody either, which makes us be able to tell it like it is.
Yeah, definitely. And speaking of the radio show awards, if you go to Kenny's Facebook page, tab down a little bit. I've actually posted a link on his page for the Wrestling Radio Show Awards. For some reason, I can't get a hold of those fuckers that run it.
So, oh, yeah, I guess you got... No, they don't want none of us. The last thing they want to see light up on that chart is the Bolin Alley and have that as an option to be able to vote out all these other nonsensical shows
and
that do not tell it like it is, like me and the Prince, that don't entertain you like me and the Prince.
Oh, exactly. And there is...
Have a quality host like Rob Diggin, not some uneducated mark that's sitting there talking about what he's seeing on television and talking about Monday Night Raw and him trying to critique what he's seeing in the ring when he's never even been in the business.
Yeah.
If you ain't done it, you can't critique it. I can promise you that.
Yeah. And you'll have these marks that'll say, oh, well...
Why don't I teach Pete Rose how to hit, huh? Why don't I do that?
Yeah. You'll have these marks sitting around saying that, how do they have any right commenting on Matt or Jeff Hardy because they've never been in the WWE and they've never done this and they've never done that.
Well, that's what I take it you're saying they were talking about me and the Prince.
Yeah, well, yeah.
So this is where I got news for you. I might not have been in technically the WWE, but I worked with and alongside the WWE for 9 long years. And I was affiliated with them even long before that ever happened, through Jim Cornette and through other friends. I've been backstage, I've been critiquing people for a long time, even before I started getting paid for it. And I can assure you, there ain't nobody that knows more about the inner workings of the WWE, the backstage politics, the bullshit that goes on in both companies, than me and the Prince. We have been exposed to it all, we've seen it all, we've done it all. And just because you ain't seen us on the television show... Well, you saw me a couple of three times and a few highlight reels and in a couple of little bits they wanted me to do several years ago with Kane. But just because you don't see me as a regular character on the show don't mean I don't know what I'm talking about. And when it comes to the Hardys, or if I'm talking about Kane, The Undertaker, Stone Cold Steve Austin, or any of those, or Bobby Heenan, or anybody that's ever been on that show, if I'm talking about them, I know what I'm talking about. I've been there, I've seen it all, I've done it all. And ain't nobody covered it like I have. Nobody.
Definitely. And, well, as far as topics go, why don't we just go ahead and start off? I've got a few here.
No wonder we're on angry marks. I sound angry tonight, don't I?
Yeah, you know.
Season finale, you think I'd be in a better mood.
Well, we were actually, believe it or not, we are starting to get more listenership because we were picked up by TV Tracks on YouTube.
Yeah,
and they're now starting to cover the show, which is getting us actually more listens and more subscribers than we've ever had. So,
well, it's a slow building process, and like I said, I think we found out that some of the numbers that were coming. What was that other show I used to do? What was that called?
Oh, Who's Slamming Who?
Who's Slamming Who? Well, we think they might have been fabricating the numbers over there a little bit. We're not sure because they claim we were over 100,000 listeners. A week over there, but Rob Dickens says he's done a little investigating and he's not sure how accurate those numbers were. We know we had a lot. We have no doubt about that just through the email feedback, but I think 100,000+ was a little exaggerated, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it definitely was.
Not only for us, but for Cornette or anybody else, because there were some that were hanging with us that we knew were not hanging with us. People like Lanny Poffo, people like John Cena Sr., the Iron Sheik, and their shows went away, and they went away because the Bolins put them in their place. They couldn't argue with us. They could not debate with us, and they went away like the little cowards that they were. And they tried to act like their shows could hang with ours. Not even close, and that's how they got ran off. The fans didn't want them. They wanted the Bolin Alley. And then when we started beating Cornette's commentary, that's when they really got upset and had to close shop over there. Because they did not like the Bolin Alley being a guy, like they say, who hasn't been on national television. I don't have the worldwide television fame that all these other guys have. But I have acquired my fame through taking guys from dirt in Ohio Valley and turning them into millionaires. I put 54 men into the WWE. My biggest claims to fame are John Cena, Mark Henry, The Miz, Rico Constantino, people of that ilk. And that's what I've done. And you never heard of any of those people till after I trained and developed them and sent them up there, except for other Mark Henry, who had some national fame through the Olympics.
Yep.
And that was about it.
And speaking of the Wrestling Radio Show Awards, Stevie J from Angry Marks actually said that none of his shows were nominated either. So.
Oh, yeah. See, it's all politics, and we're not going to worry about that. And when it comes to politics, I'm an independent, and I'm not going to align with any of these shows to get votes or media recognition. We know we're the best show. We know we're the most entertaining, and we don't need some award show to tell us so. I mean, it'd be nice if they would acknowledge us and admit that we're the best show on the air and the most entertaining and the most educational, and that you'll hear stuff here you won't hear anywhere else. And we don't have to have a bunch of the most famous guest on in the world to make people listen to our show. That's not what we need. I could have somebody famous on every week if I wanted. It's not necessary. You want backstage dirt, you want, and we're not really going to give you backstage dirt on OVW, because that's my little prize there. And what goes on at OVW, I try to make sure it stays at OVW. Every now and then a little something will leak out, but it ain't on my end.
Yep.
But as far as all these other companies going on, you know, they all talk and they all tell me everything. They all call me for advice, and they all want to know, what would you do, King? You know, you've survived 18 years with one company. How come the rest of us can't? Why do the rest of us get heat and get ran out on a rail like Johnny Nitro, like Maurice? All you got to do is voice your opinion with one of those companies, and they'll quickly run you out. Well, I've ran my mouth and my opinion at OVW for 18 years, and whether they like it or not, they at least respect what I have to say. And they've come close to firing me a few times, and have, but before my hand would hit the door, they realized they were making a monumental mistake and would normally correct that problem before I officially left the building. I've stayed loyal with Ohio Valley Wrestling for a reason, because I wanted to stay here in Louisville. I like the living that I make. I guarantee you people, I made more money today, and I ain't bragging, I'm just telling the truth. I made more money today here in my hometown than, short of John Cena, The Rock, and Stone Cold Steve Austin, than I guarantee you anybody in the WWE or TNA today. And that is based on local and regional fame. And I'm very proud of what I've done in the wrestling business, and I'm kind of the Jerry Lawler of this area. Jerry Lawler never had to leave Memphis to accomplish everything that he did. He became one of the biggest names in the wrestling business, and everybody came to Memphis to get a rub from Jerry Lawler. And down here, I'm not even a wrestler, I'm a manager. And everybody comes to Louisville to get a rub from Kenny the Star Maker Bolin. I don't have to go anywhere. I can stay right here. I don't have to go 90 miles away from my home if I don't want to. And I've lived a very nice life. I'm not sickly wealthy like some of the big stars in the WWE. But I do all right, and I've saved my money very well. And let's put it this way. The Prince is going to live very, very nice for a long, long time once I leave this planet.
Definitely. And
at least 6 or 8 weeks.
Yeah, and
the way he spends money, it might not last that long.
Yeah, you might need somebody around to make sure that they don't try to fuck him when you're gone, too.
Well, as long as the Prince handles his spending habits, he should be okay.
I think he can do that. Well, let's start on the topics.
I tell you what, before we hit the topics, let's, as an apology to those that have had trouble getting in the chat rooms, do we have any questions from the chat rooms quick? And we'll try and knock out a couple of those.
We do.
And then we'll get into some topics.
They do have some questions.
Yeah, let's not ignore them. We gotta be good to those people.
We've got one question from the chat room from, let's see here, trying to see the name. His name is Guest.
Okay, well, nice to meet you, Guest. You original cocksucker, you.
He wants to know what your thoughts are on the Hulk Hogan suing Linda for defamation and gay rumors.
Well, number one, I didn't know that he was. So now that I do know that, Hogan is a... That's right, we're affiliated with TNA now, aren't we? Hogan's a sad, desperate man. I'll say it. And if he's got a problem with it, he can come up here to Ohio Valley Wrestling and talk to me about it. What he was and where he's at now upsets me. It upsets the Prince. And it's sad that he's having to go down that road. And like I said, if people got a problem with it, you know, TNA doesn't cut me a check. I cut my own checks. So I'll say what I got to say. And like I said, I always say the truth. I know Cornette, you couldn't get him to say a bad word about ROH or TNA or WWE when he worked for them. But when he left, he had all this bile and anger built up, and he talked about them like dogs. I'm not going to talk about them like dogs. I'm just going to call a spade a spade. And I'll tell the truth. If there's something good going on and I like it, I'll talk about it. If there's something negative going on, I am glad to see that it does look like Jeff Hardy is making some strides in the right direction, because I was not convinced that that could happen. And I was one of the most critical of the Hardys. I never dreamed that Matt would pass Jeff in the Disgrace of Hardy competition they had going on there for a while. But from what I've seen, it looks like Jeff is walking the straight and narrow here the past several months. And I hope it works out. I really do. He's a good kid at heart. I've met him many times. I worked with him in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. And he's at heart, he's a good kid. And I always thought Matt was, too. I never dreamed that Matt would go down that road. But the wrestling business does strange things to people who are not mentally tough. And I don't mean to say they're not mentally tough, but when you choose some of the directions they're going in, that's the only way you can describe it. I'm 51 years old. I'm 20 years older than a lot of the guys I'm talking about. I've seen it. I've experienced it. I know the right way and the wrong way, and sorry guys, that's the wrong way.
Yep, definitely.
But Hogan should be the richest son of a bitch in the goddamn planet Earth. He should have not had to drop another ass drop 15, 20 years ago. He should have had one last match in the WWE. Maybe the one with The Rock would have been a good way to go out. And end it and live off your fame for the rest of your life. I mean, I have not done anything here in OVW in the last 6 years, and I'm still one of the most hated men in OVW. And I haven't done anything to anybody in 6 years. That's called living off your fame and the legacy that you've developed. And Hogan could have lived off his a far lot damn longer than I could off regional fame that I have here in Louisville and the tri-state area.
Definitely.
And fortunately, dude, the internet has really helped my fame quite a bit. I've got fans all over the world, and it amazes me, and some of the letters I get and where they come from that appreciate what I do and what I've done. So the internet really changed it. If I'd gotten into the business 20 years ago and gotten out before the internet, I would have just been a local hick in Louisville, Kentucky that only Louisville fans would have known. So the internet has really helped me out there. But Hogan has had he's had both ends of it, and he should be the most set. Yeah, him and Flair, they ought to be the most set two guys in the world. And right now, both of them, they've embarrassed a lot of us, and that needs to change.
Yep, definitely. And another.
And if anyone at TNA is mad at me about that for speaking the truth, then you know where I'm at.
Right.
Don't hold OVW accountable. This ain't an OVW show. This is a Kenny Bolin show.
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely.
The views and expressions expressed by one Kenny Starmaker Bolin and the Prince Bolin are not necessarily those of OVW. So there's our disclaimer.
By the way, I just want to make a mention. We are going to accept phone calls later on, but wait till we get done with the actual topics that we've got from listeners. And we'll open up the line. I know we've got a couple people that are trying to call in right now.
Well, that'll be fine.
So we'll open the line up after we're done with the topics. But hang on just a little bit, and we'll let you call in. So Hulk Hogan suing Linda for defamation. We've got that out of the way. We've actually got an email question from Kevin Barrett.
But if Linda says Hogan's gay, who better to know than her? So
right,
Yep. And I guess...
Old Limpy himself.
I guess the gay rumors were about him and Brutus Beefcake.
They've been awfully close. I'll leave it at that. They've been awfully close. I have not seen anything. Nothing. I'm not at Penn State University peeking over Sandusky's shoulder. I haven't seen anything, but a lot of people saying it.
Just don't drop the soap.
Oh, no.
An email question that we got. I think it's from Kevin Barrett. I think his name is
Kevin Barrett. I think I've heard of that clown. What's he asking?
He wants to know what your opinion would be on. Well, what would be, in your opinion, the best-looking belts and the worst-looking belts of all time?
Worst-looking belts currently are the tag team belts. I don't know if they're on SmackDown or Raw, but I saw them here a while back. They look like fucking glorified, shined-up pennies that have been blown up 100 times their natural size. Those are the worst-looking things I've ever seen in my life. The best-looking belt, I love the old Southern... the old Southern heavyweight title belt that Jerry Lawler had that had the two or three plaques on each side, a nice medium-sized center plaque, and it's hard for me to describe, but those that knew the belts that Jerry Lawler had in 75 and 76, maybe a little bit of 74, would have a better idea of what I'm talking about. I thought that was a good-looking belt. I thought the AWA world title was a good-looking belt. The one that Flair had I really liked. I thought it was awfully big, but, you know, shit, if you're the world champion, you know. If you're the world champion, you need a big belt, I guess. But, no, the worst are those tag belts going on right now. And I hate anything that's got the multiple colors. If it's got the red, white, and blue and all that. No, you know, your championship belts are gold and silver. And maybe with a touch of color to accent whatever it is your writing is. But, no, these big colored things are a joke. Let boxing have those. Maybe MMA.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, the one that looks like they look like pennies. The tag team.
Oh, they're sad. Those who the hell made those? And then who's the asshole that says, "Yeah, it looks like a good idea"? I mean, doesn't anybody critique anybody's work anymore?
That's got to be.
Someone signed off on that and said, "Yeah, that looks good."
That's got to be.
Somebody did.
It's got to be a Kevin Dunn idea.
Well, I've heard from educated people that he's a dumbass, and I normally try to listen to educated people because dumbasses never gave me any good advice ever.
Right. And here's a little bit of news. Your girl from Tough Enough, Rima Fakih, was actually...
I love her. She could fuck up every single day in life, and I'd find a way to love her, but go ahead.
Well, she was recently pulled over and given a DUI.
Oh, God damn it. I can't even pick Miss America and not have her fuck up. DUI, that's right down in Florida, wasn't it? Go figure, drinking in Florida and you got pulled over for a DUI. Who would have thought that could have happened? Every fucking dumbass that's ever put on a pair of wrestling boots in Florida, it seems like.
Yeah.
What's Miss America's first name again? Rima?
Rima Fakih.
Rima, honey, come on. You're Miss fucking America. Jesus goddamn Christ, there ain't somebody that would drive you somewhere? I would come from Louisville, Kentucky to Florida to drive you anywhere you want to go, and I have no intentions of ever driving more than 90 miles ever again. But I'd do it for you. So I know goddamn well there's somebody in Florida that says, "Hey, I'll drive Miss America around while she gets sloshed all night, and maybe I'll get some." That'd be my motivation anyway. No, I love her. She's a gorgeous woman. Good work ethic from what I saw. I think she could be an excellent diva. I don't know if she'd be a great wrestler, but goddamn how many of them are.
Right.
There's
right.
A handful of the girls that are really that good anyway. You'll never convince them of that. Every damn girl who's ever gotten in the ring thinks she's the next fucking Luthez. And if y'all get mad at me, fuck you. You can't bribe me with your pussy, so... I've 51 years of age. I've been there. Your shit don't impress me. I've seen it all. You might be able to get these little boys you work with to bow down and kiss your ass and date you throughout all the companies that you cross-reference, but it don't work on me, so I'll tell you what you are. If you're good, I'll fucking tell you, and if you suck, I'll say that too.
Yep.
A lot of you fucking suck.
And
unfortunately, you suck in a good way to keep your jobs.
Yeah.
Well, I'm getting carried away tonight. Good thing I ain't naming names.
Yeah. Just as long as it's not in that one promotion. I think you're okay.
As a matter of fact, we have a girl in OVW right now, and I'm not gonna name her name because I don't want to embarrass her, but she knows who she is. And she has made a vow that she's going to be one of them here that doesn't sleep her way to the top. She's going to make it on whatever skills she's got. I ain't going to be banging the boys. I'm not going to be banging people in the office. I'm here. This is what I've got. I'm going to do my best. And if that's good enough, great. And if it ain't, well, dadgummit, we tried. And you know what? I respect that. Because there's about three girls I can think of that got into the business that did that. Molly Holly's one of them. I'm blanking out on the other one's name, and I've even had her to my house. She was one of the top divas in the WWE. God dang it. Shit. If her name comes to me, she was about 40 years old when she was in the WWE.
Ivory,
yeah. Swore she would never get the fake ones, and I think eventually she ended up caving in and did. But no, those two impressed me. And Jackie was another one. Jackie, once she got substantiated in the business, apparently wasn't going to play that game with everybody, and she would make it on her skill. So there's been maybe three or four that I know for a fact. And now there's one of those three or four that I don't think was always that way. But matter of fact, I know for a fact. But we won't talk about which name. But I'm very proud of this young lady in OVW that's told me that's how it's going to be, because there's others that come in, hey, I'll blow or suck whatever it takes to advance, and there's a lot of those floating around out there too, and that's how they all end up with each other.
Yep, absolutely. And another listener wants to know what your thoughts are on Kane making his return with his new Leatherface mask.
Well, it looked like that black mask got eliminated there at the end. I was scared to death that was going to be the new mask. Kane and I had a talk many years ago when he was doing a Six Flags show. And I asked him, I said, what if WWE asked you to do away with the mask? What would you do? He said, I would fight it. He said, I would never want to lose my mask. He said, that is my gimmick. I said, I agree with you. He says, but I'll be honest with you, it's hard to breathe, and it's very difficult to work in that mask, but I know it's my moneymaker. I said, I agree with you. So, of course, the first time WWE asked him to remove the mask, he did. And he liked it so well because he could breathe, and he could be whatever it is that facial image he created. And he didn't have to hide anymore. You know, he had an image where he could be recognized, because no one ever recognized him in public before. They just knew he was big. Hey, that might be Kane. He's a big guy. And it wasn't his real hair, so he always was able, you know, he never looked anything like the character. So when he went bald and did the thing, you know, then that was at least facial recognition. And plus, he did the baby face thing, so now you can go out and do the personal appearances and be recognized when you're out in public. I've always thought he should go back to the mask, and yes, they have enhanced the mask a little bit, but I think in order for him to be able to breathe. If you can't breathe, you can't wrestle. We've always told people that.
Yep.
And so I don't have any problems with the alterations to the mask if it's going to help him perform better.
Absolutely. Another listener wants to know what your thoughts are on the tag team division in any promotion really being in the shitter.
Well, even at OVW there for a while, the tag team belts were kind of looked at as a joke. And when my son got in, his goal was to eliminate that bullshit. The heavyweight title is your focus title. That's your main event belt whenever it's defended. Your television title should be defended on television. That's what it is. It don't need to be defended in other arenas. It is a TV title defended on TV. And then your tag team titles are number two next to the OVW title or whatever. You know, the tag team is always number two as opposed to your heavyweight championship division. And your women's title, if you have one, would be considered probably four next to the television title. Why? Because women's wrestling is not normally the most focused thing on your show unless you're GLOW. And I don't think that's on anymore. So TNA has an impressive women's division. A lot of their women can work, as opposed to a lot of the women in the WWE. And I'm certainly not talking about Natalya or Beth Phoenix or a couple of others up there. I think Victoria is phenomenal, and down in TNA. And I think Velvet does a pretty damn good job, and plus looks pretty good doing it. I thought Maryse was one hell of a heel. I was very disappointed that she went, but she was too good for the WWE to begin with. She's too beautiful, too smart, and doesn't need to be in there bumping around like a damn fool. But she was the best heel female the WWE had, and better than most of the men. And the sad thing I just saw in TNA is where the Jarretts have been fired. I got a feeling that the Jarretts want some holiday time off like the Bolins, but they went a different way to get it. But Karen Angle is probably the top heel in TNA, in my opinion.
Yeah.
She's way better than her husband, way better than her former husband, and way better than whoever she dated when they found her. I think they claim she was found in a strip club before when Kurt Angle found her. I don't know. That's what I've heard.
That wouldn't surprise me.
don't need Kurt Angle or Jeff Jarrett wanting to come up here and whip my ass. I'm just saying what a lot of other people have said. But in a complimentary standpoint, Karen Angle is the best heel TNA's got. I believe what she does. I like her presentation. And this ain't me thinking that Karen Angle is hot looking and just drooling over because she looks hot. I think she's a good looking woman. There's several other women in TNA that I think look better from a sexual standpoint. But from an overall persona and overall heel standpoint, Karen Angle, in my opinion, blows away everybody there. I buy her shit every time I see her cut a promo. I just sit there and grin. Because if you're going to talk, if you're going to cut one, goddammit, make it real. And I feel that's what she does.
Yep.
I think Bobby Roode has come a long way. I was not on the Bobby Roode wagon probably as recently as a year or two ago. As a matter of fact, I hate to say this because he's probably going to get pissed off when he finds out about it. I had him taken off a show that he was being booked on because I thought the pay that he wanted was ridiculous. I knew in that town he wasn't going to draw enough to pay the pay that he was wanting and his flight and his hotel and his meals. And I said, that's ridiculous. You asked me my advice. I said, just your girlfriend wants him on the show? Let her fucking get a job and pay to have him up here. I said, and you know what? If it were me, I'd tell you don't book me either because I'm not going to sell you that many tickets. Bobby Roode ain't going to sell them. But you know what? Chris Jericho is going to be here, and I know what you're paying him. Well, guess what? You're going to make your money back off Chris Jericho. So that was the I was not on the Bobby Roode bandwagon, but he has come a long way in the last two or three years. And I think James Storm has come a long way, too. Promos have gotten much better. And they're not The Rock and Stone Cold Steve Austin yet, but not that they ever will be. But they've come a long way from where they were over the last two or three years. I've been very impressed with them.
Who did they?
I told you I'm not going to totally shit on TNA or WWE or anybody. If you're doing good, I'll be the first to say it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if you're impressing me or if you're impressing the Prince, if you impress one of the two of us or even Jim Cornette as negatively as we can look at the wrestling business these days, if you can impress one of the three or all three of us, you're fucking doing something right. Because we've seen it done at its best, and we've seen it done at its worst.
So, in your opinion, who does Bobby Roode and James Storm remind you of?
Who, if I, not really exactly like them, but a little bit of Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard. Different styles, but similar personas and similar standings on the evolution chart of the company that they're in. I like AJ Styles, but I think his promos are not very good. I don't like AJ as a heel. I didn't like him trying to do the suits and the Ric Flair bullshit. And but he is a phenomenal wrestler. He is that for someone his size. Do I buy him beating grown men? Not that often. Not that often. And once again, people are going to get pissed, but this is a business of perception. And if you look like Hulk Hogan, you're not supposed to get beat by anybody that looks like AJ Styles. Shawn Michaels is one of those exceptions. And I know all the little guys out there getting pissed. We can beat people too. No, the fuck you can't. Shut the fuck up. Beat up other little people. When I was in high school, the little people beat up little people. Big people beat up big people. And big people always beat up the little people. The little people never had a fucking shot unless they were goddamn martial arts expert or something and got lucky on a big guy. That's the only time it happened. And that's what people expect in the wrestling business. If you're sitting in the crowd and the wrestler comes over and draws back at you and you don't flinch, then something's wrong. They're not scared. The persona is not there. Just because it ain't real, believe me, if I draw back on somebody, even my fat manager ass, the look in my face, the look in my eyes, the tone in my voice, you're going to fucking move. Or you'll wish you did.
Yep.
Make it fucking believable if you're going to goddamn do it.
Well, since we're on the TNA thing.
I didn't know we were, but go ahead.
Well, we were talking about Bobby Roode and James Storm.
Yeah. No, I think they've made tremendous strides. I'm proud of both of them because I was on neither wagon for quite some time, but they're doing much better.
Muscagney Fan 1 wants to know.
Muscagney's got one fan? Well, that's a start.
Well, he wants to know who you think the next major star to go to TNA out of OVW is.
The next one? Because Barella's already been down there. Woo! I tell you what, if they were smart, and I don't know how smart they are yet because our working relationship has only been just a few weeks now, but if they were smart and they were going to take anybody from OVW, I think you'd have to give Jason Wayne a hard look and Anthony Thomas a new sensation that you might want to keep an eye on. He's going to be gold. He's going to make somebody some money. I don't know if it's WWE, TNA. I don't think he's ROH's cup of tea, but who knows? Cornette starts sniffing around down here. He might find some use for him. Mark Anthony, I think, is his name. I might have got his name wrong.
Yeah, Marcus Anthony.
Yeah, there you go. So many names running through my mind, and plus I'm a sick man. I tell you what, now he's very early in his career. And I'm leaping him over a few guys, but as far as genetic structuring, what I've seen in his early matches, I take a chance on him. I was one of the ones that said if I was going to build a wrestling company, I'd start with Matt Morgan, and I wouldn't make him a fucking stutterer. And I said that a long time ago, and Matt Morgan appreciated that. If I'm going to take a brand new guy to OVW, Muscagney's gotten very lucky. He lucked up, and he signed Marcus Anthony before the Prince did. Prince has been focusing on some other things and might have let one slip through his hands. But just because he's with Muscagney now, you know, the Muscagneys have a lot of money and the Bolins have access to a lot of money. The thing I got in my favor is all the money I have to play with ain't necessarily mine. I got a friend named Mark Cuban who, when I told him about John Cena, started filtering money up here like you wouldn't believe. And if I introduce him to Marcus Anthony on a little private plane trip at a Dallas Mavericks game against the Lakers, and Marcus Anthony and the Prince and the King are sitting in the front row, and maybe Muscagney's out on a gambling boat somewhere, wasting his money, he might not wake up and have Marcus Anthony with him for a night. I'm not saying that'll happen. I'm just saying business is business, and you better watch your prize. You better watch your prize, because I don't think Muscagney can sign anybody away from BS. But I am saying that the Bolins are pretty good at what we do, and he's got something that me and the Prince like. So he better watch him real close. And that's just friendly business. That's all I'm saying. That's just friendly business. Me and Muscagney are friends. I'm pretty sure if we swooped in there and took Anthony from him, he'd be mad for a while. He'd get over it, though.
Yep. absolutely.
But those are the two right now that I think could make an impact in either company. And we have some others that are awfully good, too. But those are the two that I would focus my attention on as far as the first two to be signed to either TNA or the WWE.
Okay.
Somebody better get some ink on their contract. That's all I'm telling you, because somebody's going to sign them.
Absolutely. Let's see. Dustin from the chat room wants to know your thoughts on a John Cena heel turn.
It, for wrestling-wise, it would be the greatest thing for the business since the CM Punk situation. What people fail to realize is that the CM Punk thing, even though for me it was one of the most entertaining things I'd ever seen, I was popping for it like a kid watching Monday Night Raw for the first time. And it's hard to do that to me because, it's like I said, I feel that I've seen it all. But the shoot stuff was not allowed in my era and the era that I grew up watching. Or if it was, it was just vaguely touched upon. You rarely saw shoot interviews, and Punk was apparently granted permission to do so. Not a lot of companies are going to let you talk about all their embarrassing failures. I mean, you saw that video that they did on Laurinaitis. Do you really think that they would ever let me or the Prince put together a video like that about Danny Davis?
I don't think so.
We can make the video, but there ain't no way it's going to air. You know, the production crew, Danny Davis will have that shut down in a heartbeat. Now, we don't feel that way about Danny Davis. That's a whole other thing. John Laurinaitis is a bumbling fool. Everybody knows that. So it's the fact that he is a bumbling fool and is highly disrespected and disliked by all the wrestlers that they would air that on television. That's supposed to be backstage information. And the era that I grew up in, Jerry Jarrett said it best. There used to be wrestlers knock on the door and want to wrestle for Jerry Jarrett. Yeah, I'm so-and-so, and I worked up, and I'm smart to the business, and I'd like to work for you. Oh, really? Well, you might be smart to the business, but you're not smart to my business. And that's how we've always handled it at OVW. You know, you might get all that backstage shit out of all these other companies. Well, you're not getting it out of ours. Well, we've had a couple of infiltrators. We've had a couple of guys get on the roster, but in this day and age of tweeting and Facebooking and venting about what's going on, and they like to go on and talk about shit they shouldn't be talking about. And there's going to come a day that the top brass is going to get fed up with it, and those people are going to be released immediately, and they're not going to be allowed in the show no more if you can't keep business business. Because how are we going to continue to entertain and surprise people if you got people backstage to vote? You know, WWE can't surprise any because there's always some cocksucker in the back that's got to tweet somebody and divulge everything they're going to do.
Right.
You can't fucking surprise anybody anymore. And the element of surprise weighs heavily in the wrestling business. If you're not surprised every now and then, what the fuck are you watching for?
Gotcha.
And surprise me. I want to be surprised.
Right on. Yeah, well, me too. I want to be surprised too.
Well, we all do, but everybody wants to fucking tweet, so.
Yeah, and everybody wants to.
And these NBA players and these football players, put your fucking Twitter and bullshit down. Play fucking football. Make a legal hit on somebody and shut the fuck up. And that goes for the goddamn wrestlers too. Jesus Christ. Why you got to divulge everybody's fucking business? Somebody's cutting you a check to do what you love. Take your check, do the best job you can do, negotiate for the best money that you can get, and shut the fuck up about what's going on backstage and whether you're getting a push or not. Be glad you're getting a check. There's maybe 150 people that make a good living in the wrestling business, and the rest of them are struggling. And if they say otherwise, they're fucking lying, because I know who they are. Maybe 150, 250 at best. And everybody else is barely fucking making it.
Right.
I've been very fortunate because I set up a pretty good situation for myself 18 years ago in Louisville, Kentucky. The first 7 years, I struggled like a motherfucker too and was barely paying the bills. And I had to get very creative at how I was going to succeed in the wrestling business, not being Nick Bockwinkel. Not being Bobby the Brain Heenan, But you know what? I fast realized that Bobby Heenan and Jimmy Cornette and Captain Lou Albano and all these great managers aligned themselves with already established great wrestlers. None of them ever developed anybody from dirt. I'm the only one who's ever done that. And made as many... And y'all think I'm blowing my own horn? Who better knows the tune than me? And I'm very proud of what I've accomplished in this business, never to have really been a focused character on a national television show. I guess OVW is considered worldwide because it's always been available on the internet and through DVDs and everything. But, I'd like to have OVW showing on Spike TV and the USA Network every week for the last 15 years. That'd be fucking great. Right. And you think I got a little money put away now? Put me on worldwide television for 15 years.
Right.
But with what those guys have to put up with, the backstage politics they got to put up with, the constant drug testing. I've never took a drug in my life. You got to test me because I like Big Macs and Big Red. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm very pleased and very happy. I just wish people would not have to think that you got to be on Raw, SmackDown, or TNA to know anything about the wrestling business. A lot of those motherfuckers don't know dick about the wrestling business. And a lot of the ones running it don't know dick about the wrestling business. I know who does and I know who don't, and I align myself with those who do. That's why Jerry Jarrett is a dear friend of mine.
Right.
And when Jerry Jarrett says that Kenny Bolin is the epitome of what professional wrestling is about, I don't need to hear anything else from anybody else. And when the Honky Tonk Man calls me out of everybody that he could have called to host his talk show, and he says, Kenny, just so you know, you were my first and my only choice. When I've got the Honky Tonk Man and Jerry Jarrett and guys like Jerry Lawler that sing the praises of what I've done and what I do in this business, I don't need to hear shit from anybody else because what they say don't matter. I listen to those who know.
Yeah, exactly. And I just wanted to – one thing that Jerry Jarrett always says, and people don't understand this. Like, people think that – a lot of these marks think that the face sells tickets. Jerry Jarrett will tell you straight up, and I've heard him say it before, that the face doesn't sell the tickets.
Nope, the heel never does. Has.
The heel, because every single time
the face sells pictures and gimmicks.
Exactly.
The heel sells the tickets.
And it's because
give me the top baby face versus the second top baby face and make that the main event. And let's do that for 10 weeks in a row. And we'll add up the ticket sales and we'll see where we stand. And then you give me the top heel versus the top baby face for 10 weeks in a row, and then let's add up those ticket sales. Well, I'll tell you real quick how that would be. It's going to be about 80 or 90% higher ticket sales for the top baby, knowing you got a choice. We can either go see Shawn Michaels versus Marty Jannetty, and they're both top baby faces, or we can go see Jerry Lawler versus handsome Jimmy Valiant, and Valiant did it both ways. He was a top heel and a top baby face, or Bill Dundee, who was a top baby face and a pretty good heel. He wasn't a bad heel, but he was a much better babyface. You give me that, and I'll go, and I'm going to get paid on ticket sales. You'll see me at the heel babyface one every goddamn time.
Right, and that's the thing, because people want, I mean, the reason...
You have to have somebody in the crowd, I'll agree with it to this point. You have to have somebody in that main event that the crowd cares about, like a Shawn Michaels, like a Bill Dundee, like a Jimmy Valiant, but especially Michaels and Dundee from this region. But you got to have that guy they hate, because two things are going to happen. The guy you care about is going to get his ass handed to him, and they're going to fuck him up, and you're going to feel real bad about that because he's your favorite, or you're going to get to see that big mouth cocksucker that you hate so bad get his shit handed to him. So it's 50-50 either way. Something's going to happen that you either are dying to see or don't want to see at all. Either that heel you hate so bad get his shit handed to him, or your beloved baby face emerges victorious.
Exactly.
And when you got two baby faces, who gives a shit?
Exactly.
You might see a good tactical wrestling match, and I can watch that once. And now I'm done with it.
Well, we mentioned...
Just like my midgets and just like my women. Give it to me about once or twice a year and I'll be fine. And a wrestling bear if we can find a place that'll let us do that again.
Right, and not scare away half the damn place.
Oh, Cornette made a smart-ass remark on some radio show the other day. There was apparently a broadcast somewhere about a 500-pound bear had snuck into this woman's home and fell asleep on the couch down in the basement. She walks in, 500-pound bear sacked out, sleeping, snoring his ass off on a sofa down in the basement. Cornette says, are you sure that wasn't Kenny Bolin wearing a fur coat? What a crock of shit.
What an asshole.
500-pound, thinks I'm as big as a 500-pound bear.
What an asshole. Knock off about 300 pounds.
Yeah, about 212.
Yeah, exactly.
1979.
Well, we got
in the chat room. We got any more in the chat room?
Yeah, we just mentioned Jerry Lawler a couple minutes ago.
Did he call in? How you doing, Jerry? What up, King?
Well, let's see here. JJ Allen from the chat room wants to know why.
JJ Dillon was another great manager. Speaking of JJ, so thank you, JJ Allen, for sparking me on that. But oh, JJ Dillon was excellent at what he did as well. He wasn't like me. He wasn't like Cornette. He wasn't like Bobby Heenan. But boy, he was good at what he did. I really admired his work.
He wanted to know, you know, as long as Jerry Lawler has been in the WWE past 20 years or so.
Oh yeah, I think I know where this is going. But go
why
ahead.
Why you think he's never won the WWE title?
Crock of shit. Jerry Lawler was probably wasn't the greatest worker. He might have been the greatest worker now that I sit here and think about it. Wasn't the greatest wrestler, and he'll be the first to tell you that. But as far as entertainer, and it's got to be working because he works everybody. He works the crowd. He works the announcers. He works the referees. He works the backstage people. He works everybody. And he does it with minimal effort. That's why he's 60-something years old and still looks like he's about 38, 39 years old. And I am so jealous of how he's been able to maintain that look. He never goes to the gym. Well, I never went to the gym much either once I got out of high school. And somehow he kept his weight to ride about the same weight his entire wrestling career. Never really got too fat, never really got too skinny. He looks like the same goddamn guy. If he grew the goatee and had a little thicker hair, he'd be the same guy. And I'm very jealous that he was able to maintain his weight for that entire... Because I thought I could, too, and boy, I found out different.
Another listener wants to know...
But my answer to that question is that WWE would rather shit than give the world title to a Southern-based wrestler. Because that's one reason they didn't like Ross, just because he had Southern dialect, and they fired him three times. They didn't like Lawler. Because he was too Southern. Stephanie McMahon didn't like me at OVW. She tried to get me fired from OVW, even from the developmental standpoint, which they had no say in the announcers whatsoever. But yet she stuck her nose into it, trying to get me fired. And Dean Hill, a Southern cop who became a wrestling announcer, play-by-play guy, tried to get him fired. WWE hates anything to do with the South. But every time it happened, they loved Lawler. They demanded they bring him back. They loved Jim Ross. They demanded over and over they bring him back. And if they voted on a popularity contest right now, and people want to be entertained. Michael Cole is good at what he does. That's why he does both shows. He's very good at what he does. But if the fans voted, hands down, it's going to be Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler as your play-by-play and your color guy every single time. And if they'd let Lawler be Lawler, he'd be 10 times more entertaining than he is today. Let him be the natural-born heel that he is and say what's on his mind, not what somebody's pumping through his headset in the back. He is the best color commentator going today. I can't keep up with Jerry because I do not have recital ability. I can't memorize books the way that Lawler and Cornette does. Cornette and Lawler read something, it stays with them forever. I am good at inventing shit and creating shit, and I might be able to throw in a little bit of
shit that I've heard in the past, but I rely on quick wit and coming up with new stuff. And I think I'm better at that than even Lawler and Cornette. But if they've heard something, they've locked it away, and it might as well be their stuff because it's so old from the stuff they stole it from, no one's heard it or hasn't heard it in a long time. And I would like to have their ability, but I don't have that.
Okay. Yeah. Let's see here. One listener wants to know what your opinion is on WWE trying to create this legend or old wrestler reality show that they're going to air on the WWE Network.
I've heard a little bit about it. It sounds like a fucking natural born disaster just dying to happen to embarrass some of the old stars. If that's why it's being done and what it's being done for, I'm totally against it because I don't think we want to remember our old legends that way. But if WWE can make a buck off from it and some of the boys can sit back and get a laugh out of it, they probably don't have a problem with it.
Right.
And that's why you'll probably never, ever see Bruno Sammartino ever inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame or Jim Cornette because they won't go along with ridiculous fucking shit like that.
Right.
So I'm predicting that Cornette or Sammartino will never, ever be inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame. And if Cornette ain't one of the best managers that ever was, especially that worked there, they'll put people in the WWE that never worked there.
Right.
But the guys that work there, they will, because we're pissed at them, we're not going to put them in.
Yeah, and as far as the WWE...
And if Macho Man hadn't died in that car wreck this year, you'd never see him in it either.
Right.
But the fans forced him into it.
Well, and Paul Orndorff said it best about the WWE Hall of Fame. He said...
That was another pretty good manager, too. I left Orndorff out. He didn't do a bad job either.
He said...
But then again, who the fuck couldn't manage the goddamn Road Warriors?
You mean Paul Ellering.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Paul Ellering. Orndorff, you're right. I got him confused. I told you I was fucking old, man. You got to hang with me. Paul Orndorff never managed any... Well, he did do a little managing, didn't he? Did he dabble in it there for a while?
I think he did in WCW for a short time.
And Orndorff's a nut.
Well, he said...
He packs a gun. I ain't going to say anything bad about Orndorff.
Well, and he said it best about the WWE Hall of Fame. He said that, I ate some great meals, I got a nice payday, and I got a $20 plaque that I left in the hotel room.
Well, that's saying it pretty good. that's pretty goddamn accurate. And that's taking it for what it's worth. You know, Hogan goes to TNA, but what was one of the big focal point of their angles? His fucking Hall of Fame ring. They admitted that ring was more valuable than anything the company had to offer them. That ring was greater than a TNA title. You believe that shit? That you would put over the other company's fucking Hall of Fame ring?
Right.
Well, meant a lot to Hogan. Meant a lot to him. I'm probably going to be in so much fucking trouble by the time I go to OVW Wednesday, but you know what? I'm going to be me.
Yep.
It's got to be me. I've got to be me. Y'all didn't know I could sing, did you? Champagne showers. Pop another cork, another 48 hours.
Another Muskegny fan wanted to know if you were going to be
another Muskegny fan. He's got two now.
Well, no, it's the same one.
Oh, that asshole again. All right.
Well, he wanted to know if you're going
to. So you want to know?
He must have not heard the beginning of the show because he wanted to know if you're going to be in Clarksville tomorrow.
My son is debuting in Clarksville. His in-ring debut in the tri-state area. He's professional OV wrestling debut. Of course, I'm going to be there. And I'll have DVDs for sale. I'll have pictures. I'll have autographed pictures of the King and the Prince. I'm going to have it all at my autograph table. Rob Dickin, you're going to be there tomorrow, aren't you?
I am going to be there tomorrow. And I might just have something to say if they don't give the right introduction.
Well, that's why we're going to be there. We're going to make sure the Prince is going to get proper treatment. We're going to be in the Prince's corner, and ain't nobody going to shit on the Prince while the King and Rob Dickin's around. That you got my word on. So, yeah, Muskegny fan, we're going to be there. Don't think anybody's going to be piling up on the Prince.
And by the way, if you're going to be in Clarksville tomorrow, bring plenty of money because we'd like to
bring some cash.
We'd like to take it.
We got lots of goodies for sale, and I got all the good stuff. No, I'm not talking about what y'all normally buy on a street corner in 7th and Main. Talking about pictures and DVDs.
Well, speaking of Stephanie McMahon, apparently, did you ever hear the story about how she was trying to fire Patrice O'Neal before he died?
I heard a little bit about it, and Patrice O'Neal wasn't too impressed about it from what I heard. Basically, what was the problem with Patrice O'Neal?
Well, Patrice O'Neal just died recently.
Yeah, I heard about that, and he was. I used to watch him a lot on Comedy Central.
Well, and he just did and recently. He just did the roast for Charlie Sheen recently.
Well, yeah, he was and did a good job. I like Patrice O'Neal myself. I thought he's very talented.
Well, what happened? And Stevie J is kind of telling me about this right now. He said that she actually called to fire him 6 times, and he didn't answer the phone. And he said,
he knew bad news when he saw it.
Well, he said that he didn't care because he still had his comedy stand-up shtick, you know?
Well, of course. He didn't need fucking Stephanie McMahon and her writing job. Fuck her.
And the fact that he didn't really care made her so irate that she called him 6 times to fire him.
Well, I admire him. I admire him because everybody else gets all devastated and distraught and the world's come to an end. And I've been laughed at and even called a liar because they when I heard the amount of money that they wanted to offer me to be a part of the WWE, and I said, you guys are out of your fucking mind. And that's what you pay top managers? Well, fuck you. I'll stay here and make more money and be happy, and ain't nobody going to be telling me what to do. Because that's one thing I have to say. OVW has always given me free reign to pretty much do whatever I want to do. And I might get critiqued or held back a little bit here and there when I kind of want to push the envelope a little bit. But for the most part, I've never had any trouble here whatsoever.
Yep, absolutely. And a couple more questions.
But I would be another one that Stephanie would love to call to fire because that would be an interesting phone call.
Well, of course, you're Southern, and, you know, they don't like Southern people, especially her.
Yeah, well, she's already tried to fire me, and she didn't have any luck with that because Danny Davis overrode her decision, and so that didn't pan out too well for her. So she tried. Yeah, Triple H was down here once, and he was talking about how impressed he was with the show and everything. And I said, what did you like best about the show? And he kept hemming and hawing around. I said, all right, what did you like worst about the show? He looks at me, just big grin on his face, the announcing. I said, well, as a Triple H, you don't think that was going to be a surprise to me, do you? I said, I do realize who you're married to. He says, what are you talking about? I said, you have to have me remind you about what a big fan your wife is of mine? Oh, yeah, she didn't kind of like you indeed, did she? I said, no. Well, Kenny, I like you. I think you do a great job. I said, well, I appreciate that, Triple H. Knowing he was full of fucking dog shit. No, they're not much on the Southerners.
Couple more questions here that I've got, and then we'll start taking call-ins. So,
being a season finale, I guess we'll do a 90-minute finale here. What the fuck?
Yeah. Batista apparently says he does not watch Raw or SmackDown or any of the WWE products anymore because he says that their PG wrestling is freaking brutal.
That's what Batista said, huh?
That's what Batista said.
Did Batista watch any of the shows that he was wrestling in?
Yeah, that was
pretty brutal. Did he play back any of those? Well, that's all the more reason for neither company to hire him, because if you're not going to watch the product and know what the product is and know where you could interject yourself and help either company. And I've been very critical of TNA over the years, but now that they are affiliated with us, I watch every show. And I'll watch it all, and I will do my best to be honest with what I see and what I hear. If I see something I like, I'll talk about it. If I see something I don't like, I'm going to talk about it. And I think people realize that. But I must educate myself on what's going on down there. If they're going to be sending people here, I need to know a little bit about them. And, it's just good to know what that product's doing, whether I like the show or not. Raw has been hard to watch on many occasions. especially if CM Punk ain't doing his thing, because he was about the most entertaining thing on there for a while. And it would be very entertaining. I've had John Cena as a heel here for 3.5 years. You want to see some entertaining television, get John Cena as a full-blown heel. That will be some entertaining television. They'll never do it because they're not going to want to lose the gimmick sales. And they're going to lose a lot of them if Cena becomes a heel. But I don't know where that question was going or went, but hopefully I answered it in some fashion.
And a listener wants to know if you have, because Bull Buchanan was just recently on Raw. And
yes, he was. That tickled me to see him on there. Bull Buchanan was the first ever wrestler that I sent to the WWE.
Well, and they want to know if you have any good Bull Buchanan stories.
The best story I've got aired on television here, because the story on television was that I got Bull Buchanan out of Eddyville and got him out on murder charges and got him exempted, got the governor to give him a pardon and signed him to OVW and brought him from Eddyville prison. So he's cutting his promo in the ring once, and we got a mascot named Cousin Crazy running around with a elf hat on and passing out toys to the crowd. So he's cutting the promo, and he's talking about all the stupid shit that he's seen in OVW since he's been here that he don't like, and he looks over his shoulder, and stupid elves running around passing out toys to the kids. Do you realize if the boys in the yard had ever saw me here with an elf running around passing out toys, I'd be a laughing stock. I'd be a laughing stock. And I'm going to do something about it right now. I said, Bull, what are you going to do? Because we didn't know he was going to do it. I said, that's some bitch. He's going to go out there and he's going to grab a goddamn mascot. This was not part of the show. He goes out of that ring, chases Cousin Crazy down. Crazy has no clue this shit's going to happen. He grabs him, throws him in the ring, and we're going, shit, what the fuck are we going to do? This is not the Cornette's going to have a fucking shit fit. They threw that goddamn mascot into the ring. He came in there, and Crazy was a bit of a worker. He was about 40 years old, and we figured he might have a clue to go along with whatever's going to happen, but we didn't know if he would or wouldn't. Bull grabs that son of a bitch, throws him up on his shoulders, gives him some type of muscle buster, fucked his neck up because he landed wrong, and go, well, he didn't know it was coming, and put that son of a bitch in the hospital, and we actually had to do an apology on television the next week to Cousin Crazy and all of his fans, and we did it in some smart aleck fucking way. But now he went into business for himself and decided if he was going to be a convict, that there's no way that a elf wearing mascot ought to be running around the fucking arena. So he went out and chased him down, threw him in the ring, and put that fucked up maneuver on him. And we're all looking around like, what the fuck? Now what do? We just killed the fucking mascot.
All right, well.
But no, he just went into business for himself, so that was what was the funny about it. None of us knew it was going to happen. And Cornette was sitting up there with, hey, well, fuck, what do we do now? And he asked Bull kindly not to ever do that again. But it was pretty funny.
Well, that's all the questions that I've got from the chat room right now. What I think we're going to do is we're going to take about a 10-minute break. Get yourself something to drink, Kenny. Get myself something to drink, and then when we come back...
Damn, I could use it. I didn't get anything for the show, and I haven't took my medications yet.
And when we come back, we'll take your phone calls. So we're going to go ahead and play some commercials and stuff here, and we'll be right back in about 10 to 12 minutes.
Got to pay the bills.
Hang tight, folks.
Yeah. Hey everybody, this is Stevie J from the Thursday Night AngryMarks.com Pro Wrestling and Mixed Martial Arts Podcast. You don't want to miss our fabulous show. Peter H., the Hardcore Canadian, and I discuss everything going on in the world of wrestling and MMA every Thursday night on AngryMarks.com. You can check us out there, or you can check us out on iTunes, keyword Angry Marks. That's the Thursday Night AMP from Stevie J and Peter H., the Hardcore Canadian. It's a great show from the AngryMarks.com podcast network.
Hi, Amped Radio fans. This is Rob Dickin, and it's Christmas time, which means that you actually need to run over to our store and purchase the 3-disc version of the Bolin Alley. Coming soon, and pay close attention to this, Amped Radio and the Bolin Alley official gear. We'll have more news on that coming soon, but head on over to our store and purchase the Bolin Alley. All three of the first seasons on sale right now for $19.99.
Mistletoe is hung where you can see. Somebody waits for you. Kiss her once for me. Have a holly jolly Christmas.
right, folks. We're back. Kenny, are you there? Can you hear me now, Kenny? Oh, we'll wait for Kenny to get back there. Speaking of Christina Aguilera, she looked kind of bloated on the awards recently. Got a little baby fat going on there. So we're going to actually take your guys' calls. Phone number to actually call in is going to be 859.
All righty, I'm back.
All right, there we go. So a phone number to call in is going to be 859-652-3922. You guys can call in. We'll take your questions. Be sure to call in, state your name and your question, where you're from, stuff of that nature. So meanwhile, while we wait for people to call in, entertainment industry, have we seen anything in the last about 3 to 4 months besides the award show, which, by the way, we just played two songs by the two guys that were featured at the end of the at the end of the music awards show. Which one was that, Kenny? Was that the VMAs?
LMFAO, they had two of their hit songs there that they did at the end. They stole the show from what everybody said.
They even had the old Hoff dancing with them.
Hoff had Kanan out there. Kanan's done a lot of lip-syncing videos, has become an internet sensation with millions and millions of fans. He was on the show as well. Glad to see that they gave to him. And I feel like I kind of discovered LMFAO. No one had really talked about them, or no one really heard a whole lot about them until I started publicizing them on my Facebook page, and now they're hosting the MMA. So I kind of feel like I made them stars as well.
Yeah, and even who else they have out there dancing with them? They had Justin Bieber.
Justin Bieber, they had Will.i.am.
Well, Will.i.am.
I heard some other big stars came up as they were going off the air that went up and danced with them too. So.
Yeah, Will.i.am supposedly produces a lot of their stuff.
I don't know that for a fact, but I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah, and from my understanding, he does produce a lot of that stuff. So, anything you guys want to talk about? It doesn't have to necessarily be wrestling. If you got a political question, I'm...
Wrestling, politics, current events. I see it all, hear it all, know it all. If I don't know it, I'll find it out.
You can call in 859-652-3922. Kenny, are you there?
Are you there?
Can you hear me?
I can now.
Okay, we got a little background noise there. I don't know what went on there, but...
In this day and age, you're lucky to get anybody to call in on these shows because everybody's texting anymore.
No one
has communication skills. Nobody can talk to anybody.
Well, if you can't call in, you can always just add us on Skype, Amped Radio on Skype. Get on there, add us, and just call us in through that way. You don't have to call in through phone. But we'll take your questions. I had a couple people calling in throughout the broadcast, so I just wanted to make sure that, we got
maybe those. Maybe they didn't think we were coming back after the break.
I have no idea. I know that one guy tried to call in about 8 times.
Have you got a number on him? Call that asshole back.
Okay, yeah, I've got it right here. We'll just go ahead and we'll
call him back. Let's find out what his question was.
Don't call us,
we'll call you.
Let me see if I can do outbound calls on Skype. I think I can only accept them but not call out, but we'll see.
Yeah, probably not on Skype.
Ah, it says not enough Skype credit. Well, son of a bitch.
Well, we ain't paying any of you to call. I'll tell you what, bring that number back up again. If you're not...
Oh, we just lost Kenny there. Let me add him back. Sorry about that, folks. All right.
How's that work?
That works a little bit better. Do you need the number to call?
Oh, you want me to put him on speakerphone?
Yeah, you can if you want.
I can do that. Put it on mute. Okay. We'll try this. And make sure you block this number here. Give me the number. I can't hear you, so I guess you're going to have to tell me.
Let's see, we've got... I don't want to mention his number over the air.
Yeah.
That might be a bad thing to do. We'll just wait. We'll just wait and see. We'll just wait and see if he calls in.
What are the last four digits of his number?
1809.
There you go. If your last four digits are 1809, call back. If you called eight times, you obviously had something to talk about.
Yep. So call back. You can talk about anything. So
they may not have thought we were coming back after the break. We've never took a 10-minute break before.
I personally like the 10-minute breaks because it gives us a chance that if we're going to have a long enough show, to get up and get something to drink, get something to eat, and then
We don't often get to do that. So that was nice.
It also gives the listeners a break that you know if they're listening to us.
I'm sitting here drinking a cherry Dr. Pepper as we speak.
I just had some berry flavored 7-Up.
I've had that once before, and I wasn't real fond of it.
Well, of course, you know Jimmy Cornette doesn't like 7-Up, so.
No, he's a Sprite guy.
Yeah, he says 7-Up.
And I have some of those in my fridge as well. I've got the sugar free and the sugar. And I don't know, the berry 7-Up wasn't bad. I don't guess I just wasn't nuts over it.
Oh, yeah, they said that they lost 80% of the chat room during the break.
Oh.
So that was it. Well, we're sorry, folks, if we lost you. We weren't leaving. We were taking a break that we... But, you know, if you're listening to us on YouTube and stuff like that...
Dickon, if you can, go to my wall and let them know that we're back up if they want to call in. Yeah. Maybe that'll help.
Yeah, no problem. I'll go ahead and do that.
We can edit this out of the show that we lost 80% of our audience.
Oh, here's a question from the chat room. I mean, I know we kind of quit taking questions, but it's non.
Well,
it's
if, non- if we ain't got no phone calls, we might as well take questions.
It's non wrestling related, so
sure.
Your thoughts on the Lindsay Lohan Playboy spread?
There was a day when I thought Lindsay Lohan was one of the hottest, sexiest little girls going on in the business. When she did that bit making fun, and that's funny because I'm sitting here copying a Harry Potter movie as we speak, and she made fun of she was in a bit about Harry Potter on Saturday Night Live. I thought that was the sexiest that I ever saw Lindsay Lohan. And what she looks like now, I'm sorry. I got no time for that. She just looks rode hard and put up wet. And I have no desire to see that article. It's going to be airbrushed beyond description. And I have no desire to see that whatsoever. I've seen some of the leaked photos, and I just don't think they look good.
Yeah, I haven't.
Her prime has come and gone, son. That's all I can tell you.
Yep, unless she needs to gain a little bit of weight back.
Oh too. Man, she had a little meat on her during the Saturday Night Live thing. There was actually some thighs on her, and it's just sad to see what she's become, along with being a dumbass.
That's for sure.
And from what I've heard, she hadn't got any smarter. So
we'll give you about another couple minutes here, folks, to call in if you're going to call in.
Yeah, I guess we learn better to take a break before we take calls next time, won't we?
Well, yeah. And I think the good thing is that, you know, we'll let people know ahead of time next time that we're going to take, you know.
Well, they're going to find out in fucking February is all I can tell them.
Yeah, exactly. You guys are going to be sitting there.
And take a break. Yeah, Rob, I think we ought to come back maybe the week, the Friday before the Super Bowl.
We should do that.
The Friday before the Super Bowl is probably when we ought to come back for season 5.
I don't know
if that'll be an audio or a video version. We still got to work all the kinks out on that. But before season 5 is over, we're going to have that video thing up and running.
Well, and when we go to live video, we're going to stream the live video from Louisville, Kentucky. So
you want to do that every other week, or once a month, or how often do you want to do that?
Well, I'm gonna come down there and we're gonna set up because I've got a mobile studio, so lighting set and everything. We'll just set it up. We'll you know if we can get us a conference room or you know wherever we're gonna do this at
restaurant something like that. We'll look into that. This is almost like the lights out segment of the Bolin Alley.
Yeah, we'll
just talking bullshit. And if anybody's listening, so what?
We'll consider this lights out. But what we're trying to do is, folks, we're trying to line up a restaurant or a public place where we can actually set up the set. We can have a live audience and take questions from the audience, stuff like that. And when we have live on air, you know, on the air guests, you know, there's going to be a little bit of a reaction. You know what
but
I'm
we
saying?
would like a restaurant that will be okay with us having the language as we have it now on the Bolin Alley. We want the freedom to speak our mind. We think that's a lot of what the popularity of the Bolin Alley is about, is that it is unedited and uncensored, and no one tells us what we can or can't say, and we would like to keep that at whatever venue we do this at. Obviously, we can't do this at Chuck E. Cheese. That ain't going to work.
Right, right. And we've got some places in mind. We just have to check it out. A fan wants to know if we would ever have a chance of doing a live Bolin Alley on an OVW taping.
Well, we have done live Bolin Alleys on OVW shows before, but normally the Saturday night specials. And they have not really been put up on the internet or anything. They've been available on DVD. And as a matter of fact, I did a live Bolin Alley with Cornette a couple of times. And they were very well received, but they were, you know, short editions. They were 5-10 minute versions of the Bolin Alley for television. It's a possibility. It's a possibility. I'll have to get with Danny Davis and the logistics of it and see what we can do. But there's a possibility we may look into this.
I think he was trying to ask the same question that I asked you a while ago, and I think Chris mentioned something about it, was that what are the chances of us actually doing it from the Davis Arena? I'll touch base on that.
I'll tell you why we might not be able to, is Danny does not like the strong language used on anything that gets sent out with the Davis Arena with our logos on it. He's Pump Family, but I mean, we can get by with a damn hell and a son of a bitch from time to time, but the minute an F-bomb is dropped, Danny Davis ain't going to be happy about that. Yeah. And you know, between me and the Prince, there's going to be some F-bombs dropped.
Well, and the thing that we have to consider about that and trying to inform the fans on this is that Danny runs a business. He has to be able to make some money.
And, oh, yeah.
You know, anybody that comes there and does anything from his arena is essentially using heat, is using electricity.
Oh, yeah. There's an expense involved anytime you run that place.
He has to... He has to be able to be compensated for that so he can pay for it, you know. And right now, I mean, as far as the Bolin Alley goes, we're pretty much non-profit. You know, anything we bring in pretty much goes right back into the show.
Pretty much.
You know, us being able to rent some place is really not on the radar for us at this point. So we're trying to find a place that's going to partner with us that would allow for people to come in,
if those 10,000 listeners we got, if those cocksuckers that have paid $1 each, then it'd be amazing what we could do with this show.
Oh, exactly, exactly.
One measly dollar out of all 10,000 of you, that's all we needed.
Cheap bastards.
It amazes me that we get that many listeners, but so few that actually will make the phone call or go into the chat room, that they just listen. You think they would want to interact.
Fucking marks.
Well, it is angrymarksradio.com, yeah. Isn't it?
what we're trying to do is we're actually trying to get a place so we can have a live audience, stuff like that, charge admission. What the place will probably do is charge admission. You'll get like a drink or something, or you know, whatever they want you to do. You have a minimum. It's kind of like a comedy thing. You know, if you go to a comedy club, you have like a small admission fee, but you're required to buy like 2 or 3 drinks or something. So it may be something like that. We don't know. We're going to be looking into that. But we're definitely going to be doing.
Or it might be in a conference room just with us. Who knows? I mean, we're going to do what's best for the show. And the problem is when you have it in a setting like that, there's no way to really control the direction of the audience. There might be some topics they don't want to touch or get extremely sensitive about.
Right.
When we're just discussing it, if you get mad in your own home, that's fine. But if they try and get a little rough about how the opinions are of me and the Prince, and we do ruffle some people the wrong way, well, we might be forced to defend ourselves. And You know, you got to understand, it is television, it is radio, and just because you hear something you don't like doesn't mean that you get to get violent about it. So,
right. So, I mean, if we did do this...
We'll give you foam bricks or something if that'll make it better for you.
Yeah. I mean, if we do this in a public area, we may have to. I mean, most of the places, if it's going to be in a pizza place or it's going to be in a bar or something like that, they'll get people to actually watch those people and make sure they're not doing anything stupid.
Oh, yeah.
So, question, I guess, from somebody in the chat room wants to know if there's any chance of Danny Davis being a guest on the Bolin Alley.
Probably none. He just does not do interviews. I think he did a brief one for a newspaper last week, and we were all shocked that he even said two words. Danny just don't do those. I mean, you can throw some other names out there, but you will not get Danny Davis or Rip Rogers to do a radio show.
There we go. But as far as the live video goes, it's going to be on live stream. The reason I chose live stream is because it gives us the ability to switch from camera to camera to do our, you know, intros and have graphics up and like that when we're in the middle of the video and stuff like that. It gives us a lot more options. And it's free. We don't have to pay for a shit ton of it, you know?
So, right. Well, free is me, I've always said.
Yep, absolutely. And the good thing about it is, as many people want to watch it, they can watch it. There's no listener limit. We don't have to worry about that. But I also wanted to give them an update. I've been in the process of actually upgrading to my own audio server at home. I'm actually creating an audio server at home so that when we broadcast the audio version of it, it's going to go through my server. I don't have to pay somebody else to fucking do it. It's going to be done here and through mine and set up the way that I want it and the way that we need it. We're not going to be limited with anything. So we're going to eventually go to that, and so will Angry Marks and stuff like that, because they actually broadcast on our stream too. So that's just an update on that.
And a fine update it was.
So if you guys haven't got any more questions, I think we'll wrap it up for Season 4. You know, it's about 10 till 2 here. I'm probably going to grab myself something to eat because I haven't really had any dinner, so kind of late, but, you know.
I had chili at my mother's house tonight.
My brother.
Chili at Ma Bolin's house, and how good it was.
By the way, Kenny, before we go, why don't you update them on your health? I know most people were worried about you because you were in the ER.
What it was complications with my leg. I had to bang my leg on a dresser about 6 or 8 weeks ago, and it just wasn't healing. As a matter of fact, it started getting a little bit worse, and the pain was getting extremely bad to where the point I just couldn't put up with it anymore. So I went to the ER. A dear friend of mine, Walter Cotton, insisted that I go, and he drove up there with me and stayed all night. We was in there for about 6 or 8 hours getting treatment and medications, and of course they took all the other tests on me as well. They took my blood, checked my heart, and checked out everything thoroughly, and everything checked out fine, but they had to put me on a couple of new antibiotics to try and get my leg to heal. And it looks like we're heading in the right direction. It's starting to do a lot better, and hopefully within the next 2 or 3 weeks, they said that my leg will be totally healed. So that was what all that was about, and it was follow up time anyway. I hadn't been in the ER since January, and I like to at least get a follow up at least twice a year.
Gotcha.
So we're doing well. I expect to wake up tomorrow. But I expect to wake up every day, so.
And folks, we definitely appreciate all of your concern, because I've actually got a lot of people asking me how you're doing and stuff like that, and I know some people's been posting that on your wall.
This particular one, I didn't really notify anybody on. My own son didn't even really know much about it. I just tried to keep this one a little bit low profile. But when I've had deeper concerns, I've let people know, but I pretty much knew this one wasn't all that serious. We just needed to get my leg healed, and that's why I didn't make a big deal about it or do any postings or call ever all my closest friends and say, hey, I'm going to the ER, and I may not come out. If I ever feel that way, I'll let some people know. But
well, definitely. And I had told some people because they...
But thanks to everybody that was concerned. I appreciate your concern.
Absolutely. Well, folks, I think we're going to wrap it up for season four here. We're going to be back late January, early February. And no JJ.
We'll get plenty of notice.
And no JJ Allen. We're probably not going to have Raul Amada as a guest.
No, I don't think that's going to happen. The only way that we might come back early is that if over the holidays I can finally get Jim Cornette and Paul Bearer on the same day, like we've been trying to do, and it's going to happen. It's just maybe over the holidays we'll get a day that we can make that happen. Paul Bearer is already committed. Nothing else. If y'all just want to hear me and Paul Bearer, me and Paul will do it. If you just want to hear me and Cornette will do it. But we want to do the Super Show and get us all on at the same time. And just getting everybody available to be able to do it on the same day has just been, you know, maybe days they're available, I haven't been. So it's just been a little tougher to do than we thought it would be to get three people on the phone at the same time on the same day.
Absolutely. And I talked to Paul Bearer a couple days ago, and he said he's still up for it, and he's just waiting on a date. So,
well, maybe, so this may not be the finale, unless we do this thing in January, and then our first one won't be a video show, but it will be a nice little audio show.
Well, what
between
we meant,
me
what
and
we,
Paul Bearer, because I don't think we're going to get Paul Bearer to come up from Alabama to sit in our studio with us.
Well, and like I said, what we may do is we may come back late January, early February, and do the Super Show, the first show. Because I would like to do it then, because we can actually still take calls and stuff like we would normally. And so you can still call in when we're going to do a live version of it. You'll be able to see our reactions. We might flip you off. We might tell you off. You know, you never know.
And you said these are HD cameras and a three-camera production?
I'm getting three different cameras. They are going to be in HD quality. Well, the cameras are in HD. I don't think that we can broadcast in 100% HD through live stream.
Yeah, probably not.
Because it, for people that don't know, from a technical perspective, HD video to stream across the internet from one point to 5,000-10,000 other places takes a lot of bandwidth, and honestly, we're probably not going to have that type of bandwidth.
We're not going to have that much.
So we probably won't be able to do that, but the standard definition will still be on there. And what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to be able to record it, and then if you haven't watched it, if you weren't able to tune in at the live version of it, you know, on YouTube, we'll get the HD version up. So, you know,
nothing wrong with that.
So. At least you'll be able to watch it afterwards, and it'll be an HD version afterwards. Just live, probably not.
So if we do the Super Show, we'll notify you. We don't know if it'll be at the end of this year or the beginning of the next. But if I can get them all three together, then we may go ahead and do that Super Show, because we have been promising it for a long time.
Yep, we have been promising it for a long time. And I'm in the process of lining up some other
guests. And why don't you, because the Honky Tonk Man hasn't done my show in quite some time, and I've recently done his. So if you would like to have the Honky Tonk Man and the King on, if you show a lot of support, let me know, and I'll talk to the Honky Tonk Man, and we'll have him come on and do a show with us real soon.
And another person that I had some people express interest about being on the show was Father James Mitchell.
A very dear friend of mine, and I'm sure he would do it in a heartbeat.
So if you guys would like to hear from Father James Mitchell...
Sinister Minister, is that who you're talking about?
The Sinister Minister, James Vandenberg.
Very dear friend of mine. We will, you know what? We will do that very soon.
If you guys want to hear him too, you better let him know too. So we're trying
Let him know, and if you want him, if the support is there, we'll have him on.
And then anybody else.
But it's going to take more than 25 or 30 of you. We want to see some numbers here.
Yep. Anybody else you want to hear on, even, you know, if it's OVW guys, just let us know.
I could probably get about any of them that you would want, whether I like them or not.
We could probably get Raul Amada, but...
I'm about done with him.
Yeah, we're about done with that thought.
Yeah. Anybody else?
Anybody else?
Anybody but Raul Amada.
But yeah, that's going to wrap it up, guys. We'll let you know if we're going to have the Super Show in between now and the end of January.
Well, I wasn't going to do it, but goddamn it, we promised it to him. So, and this is Lights Out of the Bolin Alley, and we're going to find a way to make this thing happen. We're going to give them something, whether it's bad or good.
Absolutely. Well, that's going to wrap it up, guys. Appreciate you tuning in. You'll hear from us soon.
And as always, I said good day.